The book itself, this book, this is your seventh, as of last Sunday, New York Times bestseller. Why did you want to write this particular book at this particular time?
Well, I have to say that I was trying to figure out what I was going to do when I left office. And by the way, it never occurred to me that I would end up as Secretary of State of the United States. And it was the greatest job. And I have always had this kind of mantra that I want to make whatever I'm doing next more interesting than what I've done before. Not easy if you've been Secretary of State. And so I was trying to figure out all the things that I could do. I had been asked to come back and teach at Georgetown University. I wanted to set up a business. I wanted to write. I had already been asked to be chairman of the board of the National Democratic Institute, and I wanted to give speeches, and people said, well, what are you going to do? Well, it turns out I'm doing all of them because I couldn't make up my mind about what I wanted. And so I love doing all those things. And when people ask me, how do you want to be remembered? I say, I don't. I'm still here. And so the book is about the things that I've done since I left office.
And why the title, Hell and Other Destinations? Explain to those not in the know where that comes from and why you chose that title, Madeleine.
Well, the most famous thing I ever said was there's a special place in hell for women who don't help each other. And it got to be so famous that it ended up on a Starbucks cup. And I did used to say it all the time. And that's the reason for why I chose it for the title of the book. Never occurred to me that it would be so germane exactly now. Because I think in many ways we do have a choice between hell and other destinations. So I didn't, the book was written before the virus and everything, but it's a pretty good title, and others that were taken. I didn't want to call it Afterlife.
No, absolutely not. Now, speaking of what we're going through now, you draw interesting portrait of the difficulty you went through in World War II, in the context of the bombing, the ultimate adversity at that time. Tell me what lessons you learned from that adversity that have translated to you and to be usable to you in this adversity.
It turns out this is a very apt day to talk about it because it's VE Day. And I was in London as a little girl in London at that time, all during World War II. My father was a Czechoslovak diplomat and was somebody that had escaped from Czechoslovakia in March 1939. And we were in London, and I was in London all through the Blitz. My father was with the government there, the government in exile, but his job was to broadcast for BBC. And so we were in London. And for me, I now in retrospect, kind of try to figure out how my parents managed it. How isolated, especially my mother must have felt because she didn't speak English, my father did. We lived in Notting Hill Gate before it got fancy, and we spent every night in the cellar. And so I'd been trying to figure out how they did it. And in many ways, it is similar to some of the things that are going on now. They had no control over the bombs. And they always went to the cellar. The only thing they had control over was their attitude and their mood. And we don't have any control specifically over how the virus started and how, but we do have control over our behavior and our mood. And I do think that there are lessons to be learned from it. And so I obviously didn't write the part about being in Europe with this in mind, but I think it truly does show how much control we have over how we behave.
What have you been doing? What have you been reading? How do you spend your time other than promoting the book? What has Madeleine Albright been doing in this isolation to keep herself busy, to keep herself occupied? Because you are a person of constant motion.
Well, the thing that I've done, I was teaching until last week. I've been teaching virtually. And I have a fabulous group of undergraduate students at Georgetown University. And I made up this course saying foreign policy is just trying to get some country to do what you want. So what are the tools? So my course is called the National Security Toolbox, and we just did a game simulation, and then I've been grading papers. I also am chairman of the National Democratic Institute, and we are having a board meeting next week, so we're getting ready for that. And as a result of that, yesterday, Derek Mitchell, who's the president, and I, and the president of the International Republican Institute, Dan Twining, participated in a virtual hearing with the House Foreign Affairs Committee. I have also been reading myself, and I have just finished The Splendid and the Vile, which is a book by Eric Larson, which is actually about World War II and the year 1940, and it's a great book. And then I have gone and back and read something, which is The Gentleman of Moscow, which is about a man that was held in a hotel in the 1920s, and what it was like to be sequestered there. And the funny part, just to bring all this together, he was at the Metropole Hotel, which is the hotel where I stayed with Jerry when we went to Russia the first time in 1984, and we went out looking for vodka and caviar. So it's just very funny how things kind of come together.
Now, the book is mainly about what we call the afterlife, but there's also a good bit about your tenure as Secretary of State, first woman. As you look back now to your term as Secretary of State, what is the thing you're most proud of, and what is the thing you most regret?
Well, the thing I'm most proud of is what we did in Kosovo. And because, again, this is a repeated theme, my life really is very peculiar and crazy in terms of the coincidences. After the end of World War II, my father was made ambassador to Yugoslavia, and I was in Belgrade. You know, the little girl in the national costume that gives flowers at the airport, that's what I did for a living. And the idea that I would spend any time on the Balkans when I was in office, first at the UN and then as secretary, is really one of those accidents of history, because I understand the country and I understand the language. And I was disappointed at how long it took us to do something in Bosnia. And when I was secretary, I thought we really should do something more quickly in Kosovo. And we did manage to end ethnic cleansing there. And the most amazing thing, and we used force to do it. Nothing went right at the beginning, but ultimately we won. What happened was earlier this year, President Clinton and I went to Kosovo to celebrate the end of the war. And I have never been to a place where we were, Americans are so appreciated. Hundreds of American flags and tons of people there cheering us on and saying, thank you, thank you. There's a big statue to President Clinton there. And then they dedicated a statue to me. Fortunately, it's on a pedestal, so I don't look 3 feet tall. But it really is something that I'm very proud of. And it wasn't easy, and it makes a very good case study. I think the thing that I regret is that, and it goes back to the United Nations, that we were not able to do anything about the genocide in Rwanda, that it was something that was hard to do at the time. And I think President Clinton is constantly, to this day, asking, why didn't we do more? And how did the system work? And why couldn't we have done something to end the killing there?